This evening, Rob indicated, I'm going to be demonstrating how to turn this Beads of Courage box. But Jerry had a great question. Am I going to say anything about the Beads of Courage program? Yes, I am. And we're going to start with that right now. I could stand up here and talk to you about it, but instead of doing that, I've got two YouTube videos. One is 2 minutes and 20 seconds long. One is just under 2 minutes. And I think the videos will speak for themselves.
Today I'm gonna try to change the world. I'm gonna take it one day at a time.
The yellow beads represent every day I spent in the hospital. There's 12 of them.
Then I got black for pokes, and then the white ones are for infusions.
Today I'm gonna try to change the world.
It is positive to have the beads, and that's something that he does look forward to.
It wasn't really until after our son passed away, and my husband and I sat down, I think the day after his funeral, and we strung the beads together. It was a really good way for us to show our friends and our family what we had been through and what our son had been through.
Today I'm gonna try to change the world.
It helps connect the nurse to the family by taking the beads and saying, yes, I recognize that your child has been through a knot hole backwards.
Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Yes, I am.
I get a great sense of comfort as she's been through this. She can get through it again.
The beads in the program supports dreams and aspirations and innocence, and it speaks volumes to me, and I would have to be a fool to believe that I'm the only person in the world that sees what I see when I watch these kids put these beads.
I made my resolution for the look of my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Yes, I am.
Hi, my name is Hannah. I'm 10 years old, and I was diagnosed with leukemia November 1st, 2010.
My name is Eric. I am 8 years old, and I've been here for 10 months. Because I got diagnosed with leukemia in November last year.
You get beads of courage when you're going through a treatment or some kind of disease, and they all mean something. The blue ones mean clinic visit, the white ones mean chemo, the red ones mean blood transfusion, the black ones mean port access, the yellow ones mean hospital sleeping over. These three right here are courage beads. This one's hair loss. This one is like crutches or wheelchair. For me, it would be wheelchair. This one's surgery.
Every time I get a procedure or something done, like surgery or spinal tubs or bone marrows or stuff like that. I think it's a good program. It makes me feel happy. Here's my full strand. I think that they're smart kids to start the program and that they have a lot of courage.
I like doing them because in a couple years from now, you can look back and see everything that you've gone through.
So that's what the Beads of Courage program is. If you want more information, there's a Beads of Courage website. There are also probably a good 20 or 30 other YouTube videos out there about the program. And it's a pretty powerful, some pretty powerful videos, and it's a pretty good program. I first learned about this program, I think about a year and a half to 2 years ago, when the AAW started sending emails out about the Pittsburgh Symposium. And in those emails, they started referencing that they were going to sponsor a Beads of Courage partnership. And then when I went through their website, I saw a little more information. But it really didn't make a whole lot of sense to me, because I was kind of like you. I had heard about it, but I wasn't quite sure what it was. And then when we were putting together the Turning Southern Style Symposium in Dalton, we decided to do the same thing at that symposium. And since I was coordinating that, I had to learn a lot about the program so I could communicate it in all of our web mailings, as well as to the people who were there. And what and then I had a chance to go to Pittsburgh, and they actually had 325 boxes donated at that symposium. And it was pretty exciting to see that. At Dalton, we had 82 boxes turned in, which were a lot more than what we had anticipated. The program really has been embraced by the wood turning community. And if you thought the videos were good, at Dalton we had one of the mothers come to speak, and I actually had a chance to have dinner with her beforehand. And then she spoke to the group. There were probably about 150 people in the room. And I think she spoke for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. And I don't think there was a dry eye in the room when she was done. And I sat there thinking, you know, boy, am I glad I took the time to turn one of these boxes, because it was a pretty powerful thing. I personally have set a goal to have 750 of these boxes at the Atlanta Symposium, which will be significantly more than has ever been any other venue in the United States and probably the world. No, that's, well, I've actually been in communication with all of the wood turning club presidents in 8 different states. And right now I have 19 clubs participating. They've committed to making over 500 boxes. Mark Saleh is going on the road this week to 3 different clubs where he's demoing. And these 3 clubs have not signed on yet, but he's taking 100 beads with him to try to make that happen.
Yeah.
It's at least national. And the reason I say that, it's based in Phoenix, but all the boxes that are donated to the Atlanta Symposium will either stay in Georgia or the immediate surrounding states. For example, if we have a whole contingent come up from Florida and bring in 100 boxes, we'll make sure some of those boxes go back to Florida. If we get 750 boxes at Atlanta, that will probably be a drop in the bucket compared to how many they need.
Correct.
No one's going to be stockpiling these 750 boxes waiting for somebody to need them. Oh, absolutely. In fact, predating this, there were a group of seamstresses or sewers or whatever you call it making cloth bags. This is for them to keep the beads in. But before this idea came about, and still even today, there are groups making cloth bags, quilted bags, for these kids to keep the beads in also. Because as you could see in the video, it isn't like they're getting 3 or 4 beads that they can keep in a change cup on the dresser drawer. Some of these kids literally have thousands of beads. You know, that one boy in the video said he'd been in the hospital for 10 months. You can just imagine how many beads he has accumulated. His beads will not fit in this box, I'm sure of that. So that's, but I believe it's also moved into Canada. because the singer on that first video is Canadian. I'd never heard of him until I saw that video, so I Googled him, did a little research. Apparently he's a very popular singer in Canada. So I'm assuming that the Beads of Courage program is up there as well. Beyond the U.S. and Canada, I don't know.
Where do the actual beads come?
The question is, where do the actual beads come from? People donate beads, just as people donate the boxes, people donate beads.
Glass blowers,
and there are some one-of-a-kind beads. There are the standard yellow beads for this and red beads for this, but then she also referenced three courage beads, and a lot of times the courage beads are unique beads. It's almost like collecting coins or stamps. I know some of the insurance companies, like Aflac, I think Aflac makes a bead every quarter or something and donates that.
I just noticed several kids were referencing the same beads, same thing, so I figured that comes from a...
There's a color coding, yes.
The kids who were out there, all of them talked about having leukemia. Is it different diseases, or is what is it?
I believe that when it first started, it was for cancer patients. But as the program has evolved, it has branched out to include any child that's in a hospital for any extended period of time, I think for any reason, whether it's because of an illness or a surgery or whatever.
So.
If you go to the Beads of Courage website, there is a list of hospitals, and they're sorted by state. And if you click on Georgia, there's like 15 or 20 hospitals participating in Georgia. So I suspect when these boxes are picked up in Atlanta at the symposium, and we are going to make some requests. Once again, if 100 come up from Florida, we want 100 to go back to Florida. If 150 come up from Middle Georgia, we want 150 to go back to Middle Georgia, if possible. But if Beads of Courage contacts the hospital and says, well, and the hospital says, well, geez, you know, we only got three kids here, or yeah, we'll take them all, you have to balance that as well. Any other questions about the program? Okay. Having said that, let's talk a little bit about this box. If you have been to any of the regional symposiums, if you were in Pittsburgh, if you belong to any of the clubs, you've probably seen a lot of Beads of Courage boxes. If you go to the Beads of Courage website, you'll see a lot of boxes. This is one example of a Beads of Courage box. It is not the only kind of Beads of Courage box you can make. But there are several guidelines that you need to follow when making these boxes. And these guidelines have evolved over time also. So the guidelines I'm going to share with you today are a little different than a year ago. But this is what's in place as of today. The first thing is the size consideration. The inside diameter of one of these boxes is supposed to be about 6 inches in diameter. They say the minimum is 5 inches. The interior height is supposed to be a minimum of 4 inches. And right after they say that, with a big exclamation point at the end, it says large is better. So this is probably a borderline box right now. A year ago, it would have been an average to medium-sized box, but they're saying, look at these videos, look at these kids, look at how many beads they've got. There probably will be someone who can fit their beads in this box, and there probably will be someone who can fit their beads in maybe a smaller box. But if you've already made the boxes, don't throw them away. We can still use them. But if you're starting a new box, try to adhere to the new guidelines, especially in terms of space. The lid, it's not supposed to be a friction or a suction fit wood turner's lid. Think cookie jar. Nice lid. A child's going to pick this up. The knob, it's not supposed to be a Cindy Drozda finial. There's no sharp point on it. There's no sharp edges. It's a cookie jar knob. A child's going to pick this up. So those are some things to keep in mind. The finish. If you're going to use a finish, make sure that it is a finish that's going to dry, and not something that's going to be tacky for a long time or gas off for a long time. You want a stable finish. A nice square, you know, you don't want it to come down like that vortex bowl so that when they put the beads in it, it's going to tip over. You want a nice stable base. And we can, and you're supposed to label the outside of it beads of courage. Number of ways you can do this. I have seen people who have carved beads of courage on it. I've seen people who have burned beads of courage on it. Like Wes Jones even took some old letters from a Scrabble game and spelled out, he cut a channel or a recess in the top and put beads of courage in that. What most people do, it's a little logo bead that says beads of courage. And the question was, how much do these cost? They're free if you get them from me. My wife and I have bought 750 of these. That's how strongly we feel about this program. And we are making them available to anyone. To anyone who commits to turning a box. If you ask for a bead and you don't turn a box, it costs you $10. Which I think is only fair. That's how, I had a question on Saturday. How do you know these people are going to get beads? How do you know you're going to get boxes back for the beads you've given out? Well, I don't know if too many people are willing to pay $10 for a little bead like that. So.
Now, does it have to be a turn bowl?
No. In fact, the question was, does it have to be a turn bowl? And the answer is no. If you go down to Macon, there are two woodworking clubs down in Macon. One is the Macon Woodworking Club, and one is the Macon Wood Turning Club. Between the two of those clubs, they have committed to making 120 boxes. And a lot of the members down there belong to both clubs. In fact, we were at a meeting in Barnesville Tuesday night, which is a wood turning club. Three of the Beads of Courage boxes on the show and tell table were square boxes. They do not have to be round, but the inside dimensions have to be at least 4x4x6. So if you're multiplying the length, the width, and the height, and all this, it basically comes out to the same cubic volume.
What about the wood? What kind of wood?
Whatever kind of wood. The question is, what kind of wood? In this particular case, it's maple and walnut, because that's what I had in my shop. They're two 3/4-inch pieces of maple or walnut glued together. A couple of 8/4 pieces of oak on the top and the bottom. That one over there is cherry and maple because that's what I had at the time I built that box. The box I'm demonstrating tonight is all about using board cutoffs to make the box. In my case, I have gone out and I have bought some 8/4 lumber just so I don't have to glue a whole lot of 3/4-inch boards together. Because if you do the math, if you want the inside to be a minimum of 4 inches tall, and you figure you need a 1/2 inch in the bottom, and maybe a 1/2 inch of play, you need a chunk of wood that's 5 inches tall. If you're going to be gluing 3/4-inch boards together, that's like 7 boards. If you're gluing 8/4-inch boards together, that's only 3 boards. So, but if you got a bunch of 3/4-inch lumber laying around, that may be what you want to use. Because eight quarter inch lumber is not cheap, I will tell you that. So, yes. I've seen both. Question is, does it have to be a loose lid or can it be connected? I've seen both. I've seen some that have metal hinges. I've seen some that have the leather tong. If you go to one of these symposiums and you see 50 boxes lined up, or 100 boxes lined up, it is amazing the diversity in the kinds and the shapes and the colors. You even made some out of plexiglass, I think. I am not one of them, but there are some truly creative wood turners. And I look at some of these things and I wonder, where in the world did they get this idea? Who would think to use the letters from a Scrabble game to spell out beads of courage on the top?
You must have got tired of playing Scrabble.
Either that or he lost all the other letters. I don't know. But once again, this is just one kind of box that you can make. It just happens to be the kind that I like to make. But don't think that this is the only alternative. Yes? Question is, could you use a jewelry box style? Absolutely, as long as it's big enough.
What about your depth?
Well, once again, you want the inside, it doesn't matter, you need a 6-inch diameter, a 6-inch length, a 4-inch length, and a 4-inch length.
So they'd be 4 inches deep?
Yes, yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah, 4 inch. Well, that's the problem with a turned box also. It's hard to find a piece of wood that's 5 inches thick.
It's dry.
Well, even wet. If you go out and look for a bowl blank, most of them are 3 and 4 inches. You don't see too many 5-inch bowl blanks out there. Well, yeah, if you've got a chainsaw and you can harvest your own wood, you're okay.
For next year.
Well, yeah. Yeah. Any other questions before we get into the demo? Okay. So as I indicated, the first thing we want to do, we want to glue up some wood. Now, there are a couple of different ways you could do this. Obviously, you don't get wood that's round. You normally buy wood that's square. And this was a piece of the butcher block that I picked up from a friend. So you get some of this wood, and you start stacking it, and you say, okay, now how many of these layers do I need to get to 5 inches? Well, if I use these three, that's about 5.5 inches. I don't really need all of those. So let's say I decide I'm going to use these three. And you can do the same thing with 3/4 inch boards. You can do the same thing with 6/4 inch boards. Whatever thickness you want, just stack them up until you get to about 5 or 5.5 inches. That way you know how many you have to glue together. Then you have to decide, well, how wide do you want it to be? And for this evening, I'm going to focus on a round bowl as opposed to a jewelry box or something like that. But if the inside's supposed to be 6 inches, okay, maybe 1/2 inch here, 1/2 inch there, that means 7 inches. I know it's not going to be perfectly round off the bandsaw, so maybe we say 8 inches. So then you start cutting squares 8 inches by 8 inches, and you could conceivably just glue all of those up and put it between centers on a lathe and turn all the corners on off and all of that good stuff. I would not recommend it. It'd be a little chunky. So what you do is you take each one to the bandsaw and you round them off. And one of the problems I've had with circles is I have a compass at home, which is really crappy. I mean, I put the compass down and I start drawing, and by the time I get to the other side, it's off the board or it's in. And it just dawned on me as I was making this last box, this is a compass. It's a cutoff, and all I did was just drill 1/8 of an inch hole in center. I line it up with my center point. I came out here to the edge and I put a mark there. I took it to the drill press and drilled 1/8 inch hole, and it works great. I guess you can go buy an expensive compass if you want, and I'm not discouraging you from it, but this is my compass. The only thing you have to be careful of is don't break the point, because that does happen from time to time. But that works well. So if you're going to round them off on the bandsaw, someone's thinking, well, we chuck this up and then we turn all this out. Well, we don't have to turn all that out. You can saw all that out on a scroll saw. You just saw the... Well, you could. I will tell you, by the time I drilled it up with a big hole saw, my hole saw, it probably take me about an hour to do one of these boards, because I don't have one of the expensive hole saws. I got the kind that are just barely sharp. But if you're gonna glue up three pieces, I got a cherry, a maple, and a cherry, and you're going to cut the centers out on a saw. Make sure you mark them so that you only cut the center out of the top one and the middle one. Because if you cut it out of all three, you wind up with a pipe instead of a bowl. Okay? I'm just trying to share some things. I'm not trying to insult your intelligence. Yeah. But before you do that, you've got to decide, how am I going to put this on the lathe? Because if I've just glued three pieces together and I no longer have any tailstock support here, how am I going to put this on the lathe? Well, you can either use a recess on the bottom or you can use a tenon on the bottom. But you want to turn that on the bottom piece before you glue the top two pieces on. And I'll show you how to do that. I saw Harvey Meyer demonstrate this. I had never seen somebody do this before. And he has assured me that this is safe. He has assured me that he does this all the time, and he's never lost a piece of wood. I can tell you that I've done it twice, and I've never lost a piece of wood. But all he does now, I've marked a center on that. In fact, usually when I mark my centers, I mark them while the boards are still square. I just go corner to corner, punch it, and then I cut it out, because I find that once it's round, it's hard for me to find the center because it's not always round. All Harvey does is he puts the tailstock center point in that, and he just jams it up against the chuck.
I do that all the time, too.
Jack Moore says it's safe, too. For all you guys sitting in the front row, Jack Morse and Harvey Meyer say it's safe.
Just remember, I'm getting married.
You were, yes.
Thank you.
So you've got this up, and this is going to be the bottom of the body. And once again, there are really three parts to this box that you've got to make. You've got to make this, which is the body. Well, at least I call it the body. You've got to make the lid, and you've got to make the knob. So those are three pieces you're going to make. So this is the starting point, or one of the starting points on the body. In my particular case, I've decided to turn a recess. Well, obviously, the recess needs to be the right size. And the easiest way to do that is to measure your chuck to make sure you know what size it should be, which I have done. And the minimum recess I can have is 2 1/8 of an inch. That's the minimum. The maximum is 2 3/4. And I figure the sweet spot is right around 2 3/8. So what I've done... Well, you can do it any one of a number of different ways. You could... I said 2 3/8?
Yep.
Okay, this is 2 3/8 right here. You can turn that on, and you can mark it with this. That will work. You can just mark this and see what that is, and that should be about 2 3/8. Look at that. So if that's the line, then you need to decide, are you cutting on the outside of the line or are you cutting on the inside of the line? This is for a recess.
Outside of the line,
inside. No, inside.
For recess.
You just lost your recess. Right, recess, not a tenon. Okay. So there are different ways you can do this. It is everything in wood turning. People ask, well, what's the best way to do it? There's no best way. Whatever way you want to do it. In terms of the recess, you can use a recess tool. This one I bought from Mark Gardner about 5 or 6 years ago. But there's an article in the most recent American Woodturner written by Mike Peace that shows you how to make one of these things. All you need is a piece of high-speed steel. It says 3/16 by half, by about 5 inches, whatever. And you just grind it on the grinder. And you make sure that that angle is the same angle as the angle on the dovetail in your jaws. So all you're going to do is you're going to turn the lathe on. So all we're going to do, we're just going to line that up, and it sits right on the tailstock. And all it is a mini scraper. That's your recess. So now you've got the bottom of your box. You've got a nice recess in it. and you can glue the other two top pieces to it. I've already cut the recess. Obviously, I had to cut the recess on this before I could glue it up so I could use it tonight. So. And what I typically like to do is just round that off, just smooth it off. And it actually looks fairly smooth. It's riding on the chuck okay. It hasn't fallen off, hasn't hit anybody. So, thank you for. And all I'm gonna do is smooth this off. Probably didn't notice it, but I really, that entire time, I did not do this at all. I just started here and my whole body pushed it through. You just kind of shift your weight. When you approach a lathe, make sure you got 1 foot on either side, and kind of, and you can actually do it before to make sure you got enough space. But just start here and just slide your whole body. Your body's cutting the wood, not your arms, not your hands. It's just steering the tool. So all of the rough stuff is gone. So now we have to decide what shape do we want this to be. Well, I kind of like this shape where it's a little bit round at the bottom, kind of round at the top. So we'll take some of that off. That's what we're going to do right now. Another thing to keep in mind, this is dry wood. It gets hot. It's nice to have a pair of leather gloves. You probably never used the right-hand glove. If you're going to use a glove, make sure you stay on this side of the tool rest. You don't want your glove to grab a hold of anything. Okay? Once again, you can see my body is cutting the wood. And when you're turning, you're really looking over the top. You're not looking, if you look at the tool rest or where you're cutting, you really can't see what shape it is. If you look over the top at the horizon, you can see how the shape's looking. And when you're sitting right in the center, you can see that I've got a little bump here and a little bump there and starting to smooth out there. I'm going to move it a little closer. Now I'm going to try to clean it up a little bit with this long wing. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put it at an angle. I'm going to anchor it down here, and I'm just going to go like this, keeping the top wing very close, but not letting the top wing touch. You don't want to do that. Trust me, you do not want to do that. And we should get some nice angel hair off of this. And that is pretty smooth right there. Now, to finish this, I would go to the sharpener, the grinder, bring a fresh tool over and put the final touch on that. But I need to bring this all down, and we'll do that right now with the other wing. You got to remember, there really are multiple cutting surfaces on this tool. I've used the one point for one end. I've used the other point for the other end. I used one wing for this side, and I'm going to use the other wing for that side. There's no reason to use one part of your tool and then take it to the grinder. Use the whole tool and then take it to the grinder. The tools should last four times as long. And tools are not cheap, so. Another thing, I'm going to go over to do this side. Well, this thing is in my way. It doesn't have to be in my way. Now it's not in my way. It took me 9 years of turning to learn that. So, in fact, I learned that from David Ellsworth, believe it or not. I was in one of his classes at Aramont, and he was standing behind me looking at me, and he says, "Could I make a suggestion?" I said, "David, you can make as many suggestions as you want." He said, "That's in your way. Why don't you just move it?" And I looked at him and said, "Well, what would I do with it?" And he says, "Do that." I said, "Okay." So,
that's why he's paid the big bucks.
So. Yeah. And once again, you can see when I'm doing this, it's just my body going back and forth. There's none of this stuff. I've still got that one bump in the middle, the one groove in the middle. And unfortunately, to take a groove out, if it was a bump, it'd be really easy to take out. To take a groove out, you got to take everything away that's on either side of it. So we'll do that right now. And this tool is about done in terms of sharpness. So we'll get another one. And if you do this right, you should be able to start sanding at no less than 220, because you will get a pretty good finish on this. Okay, we're going to call that enough for the outside. If you're going to do something to the outside, if you're going to put beads in the center, which I have been doing on mine, if you want to cut some beads and coves in it, if you want to put some burn rings in it, if you want to do anything, now's a good time to do that. You really don't want to finish the outside yet, and I'm going to explain that to you, the reasoning for that, in just a minute. But that's good enough for now. Next step I'm going to do is just level this off, just the edge. And it was already pretty level, so it's pretty clean. Now we're going to clean out the inside. And we're not going to do the whole thing, but I'll show you what we're going to do. No, I think on something like this, a wall thickness of maybe 3/8 to a half an inch would be good. On that one, I wound up with about 1/4 inch at the top. And someone, you were talking about the bowl you made. You got to remember, you're the only person who knows what it was supposed to look like. Everybody else just assumes that, wow, that was great. I would say anything less than 3/8. Once again, think cookie jar, think substantial, think a child playing with it.
That's just what I was going to say. Then you're dropping it on the concrete, you make it too delicate.
This is not supposed to be fragile, no. So I'm just going to start to hollow this out to show you what I'm doing. And just treat it like a bowl. Even though most of the inside's going, we're coming over here, just like a bowl. We're going to nibble a little bit here. And once we get there, I'm going to touch the bottom of that wing right there. And once it goes in, we just let it slide in. That's all you got to do. That's all you got to do. One thing to remember is when you set your calipers to a half an inch, that's how thick the walls are going to be, whatever that is. That's a good wall thickness, I think. When you get to here, and it's about where that rim is right there, you got to be real careful that it doesn't go skating across the top. So when you get to about here, every cut that you take is a practice cut, seriously, in anticipation of getting to that last cut. Think about what you're doing here. I'm going to start with this, just nibbling it a little bit, and I'll try to keep my hands away so you can see it. I'm just going to nibble that right there. It's just starting. I'm not trying to hog it away. I'm taking maybe a little less than 1/8. And once it's started, it will track right in there. You don't have to have a lot of support, but it doesn't hurt to have it. So now I'm going to come out. I'm going to start a little bit more. And I'm just going to go in. Get some of this out of the way. Okay, I'm going to start again, just maybe a little less than 1/8, work my way in. Just a little bit, just catch the wing, there, it started to slide a little bit, you could see it. And then we're probably down to the last cut. just a little bit. Okay, we've cleared it. We're good to go. We've still got a nice rim that's intact. Nothing has gone skating across the side. That, to me, still looks a little thick. So we'll compare that to the calipers. According to the calipers, it's okay. And you just go the whole way down the inside of that to clean it up.
Straight wall?
Question was, is it a straight wall? I prefer that the inside wall mirror the outside of the wall. So when you get down to this, and we're kind of there here, that's going in straight, but the calipers won't go any further because the outside is flared out. So you're going to have to, and what you'll eventually wind up doing, your tool rest is going to be in there, and you're going to be in here at an angle. I mean, your arm will really be out, and you just follow it down. Just follow it down. But once again, every cut you take is a practice cut in anticipation of that last cut. So,
sorry.
Oh, okay. I just want to sure it wasn't me. So, I mean, don't just hog away the inside, not paying attention to what you're doing. Pretend that every cut you take is a practice cut, and you're getting closer and closer so that when you finally get to that last cut, it'll go right down. And I will tell you right now, it will make life a whole lot easier for you if you can cut that out with a bowl gouge as opposed to going in with a scraper. Or I should say, life's a whole lot easier for me because I don't have a whole lot of luck with a scraper. Other people do, I don't. It's a lot easier for me to cut it out. It also saves on the sandpaper. I just hate sand. I know Jack likes to sand, but I hate to sand. No?
I don't like to sand, but I don't like to see a piece that wasn't sanded properly.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe that's
an art.
Maybe that's why I hate it, because I can't sand properly.
Well, I'll teach you.
So let's take a little bit out just so we can follow that curvature a little bit so you can see what I'm talking about. No, right now I'm down to about there. I mean, it's dried lumber, but I don't think it's that difficult to turn. I mean, if I wasn't standing here talking and explaining what I was doing, I'd probably be done with this in maybe an hour. So it isn't like you're going to take a day, and it isn't like you're cutting concrete and it's going to take a day and a half to do. So let's see if we can maybe parallel this wall on the. While we do this. It's still a little thick, so we'll clean that out. Maybe one more cut if I take it at the right. So I want to pick it up close to the top, right about here, get it to start to cut. It's starting to cut. We're going to push it down. It's hard to see with the shavings in there. And it goes right down. And it's pretty clean. So you'll do that the whole way to the bottom. And then what we'll do, because my goal is not to finish one of these tonight. My goal is to show you each of the steps. And then if you're interested in the 24th, you know, we'll come in. Or if you want to work on them at home, have any questions, you know, let me know. But at least you'll know what each of the steps is. So you've hollowed the outside, or I'm sorry, you've shaped the outside. You've hollowed the inside. And the reason I didn't want you to finish the outside yet, when you go down with the calipers, what I have found is I sand this with up to like 320 or 400. Sometimes I might even finish it. And then I look at it, and there's little grooves. And it took me a long time to figure out what those little grooves were. It's the side of the caliper. So that's why I say shape it, hollow it. Now you can come up with sandpaper while it's still on the lathe. And what I will do is I've got, you know, one of the Harbor Freight right angle things, and I'll just do one of these things until I got the shape I want. I can reach in there with a hollow freight thing, and I might start at maybe, depending upon what it is, 120, work my way up until I've got it what I want inside and out. Then I will finish it. And I will also decide what I'm going to do with the bottom of this thing. Because when I put this first coat of finish on, I want to start to finish the bottom also. Because if you finish just the sides, and then you take it off, and then finish the and then turn it off and finish the bottom, you'll be able to see where that overlaps or where it's changing. So, but if you've got it done a half an inch in, then you'll never see it because it'll be on the bottom. If that makes sense. So what I'm going to do is I've moved the tool rest, and I'm going to start shaping just the outside of the bottom, just the outside. And that'll be included in the sanding process also. So when I'm done, I've sanded a little bit here, and I've finished it, I've buffed it. Everything is done on the body except for the very bottom. So what are we going to do with the bottom? Well, that's not nearly as difficult as you might think. In fact, it's probably more difficult finding the tool. Here we go. I'm going to mark my jaw so that when I take this off, I can put it back on in the same place. And you got to kind of remember the arrow is to tighten it up. So after you've turned it the wrong way a couple times. So now you got to get this off. What are you going to do? Well, what I find the easiest is to maybe bring the sides back about an eighth of an inch and then just curl it in and just take the whole thing off. Obviously, you got to hold this in the lathe somehow. And there are different ways to do that. You can use either the Longworth chuck. You can use this. You remember, all of this stuff is now gone. So just stick an old mouse pad in. This will fit the whole way to the bottom if you've hollowed it out. But whether you use this method or you use the Longworth chuck, make sure the first thing you do after you hold it in place is put the tailstock center in the bottom of the piece. Center it. Don't take this over to your desk or your workbench and put this on the Longworth chuck and tighten it all up and then try to put it on your lathe. I guarantee you it will not be centered. You will think it is, but it will not be. The key to this is centering it with your tailstock point first, and then you can turn all this off, whether you've got it jammed like this, or whether you've got it jammed on the Longworth chuck. And then you can sand it and finish the bottom, sign it, do whatever you're going to do. Thank you.